When we start a new unit of work, we do a pre-test of the main concepts we need to know. We then identify where we are using the starting, getting there, or got it model. This helps because I can analyse what I know and what I need to know. I'll show you what I mean. This lets me know which focus lessons I need to go to, and I can prepare for what I need to learn.
I'm good at mathematics. I sometimes feel like it's too easy. I can do stem and leaf floss anywhere I go. This means I can attend Mr. Lovac's extension group lesson.
I'm quite confident in most areas of mathematics. I'm able to analyse and work out most problems, but I definitely need to practice to make sure I fully understand things. For instance, in this terms unit about data, I'm getting there with stem and leaf plots, but I need to practice.
There are occasions when we complete pretests and there are unfamiliar concepts that we come across. But with the way our classroom is set up, I have gained confidence and become better at maths. These focus lessons help us strengthen our understanding of maths. To help us strengthen our understanding, we have a system where you can go to focus lessons. Depending on where you're at, come and see it in action.
Good morning, Year 7. I'd like you to take out your pre-tests, please. Today, our focus lesson will be on stem and leaf plots. Could you please take a moment now to look to see if you're starting, getting there, or got it? Okay, Year 7, in a minute, I'll ask you to move into your areas where your focus lessons will be. If you're starting, you'll be completing your focus lesson up the other end of the room with Miss McKenzie. If you are getting there, you'll be completing your lesson in the middle of the room with Miss Terry. And if you've got it, you'll be attending my extension lesson up here. Can I ask you guys to now move to those areas, please?
I'm starting on this topic, so I'll be in Miss McKenzie's focus lesson.
Good morning, students. Today we are starting to learn about stem and leaf plots. You know that you're just starting on your journey to learn them. So I hope by the end of this lesson, you will understand how to construct a stem and leaf plot and why we do that.
I think I've got it now. I'll just practice a little bit.
Lua, can I please have you up next for the feedback session?
That's me. Mr. Lolbeck is now going to talk to me about how I can improve from getting there to got it.
Hi, Lua.
Hi.
How's your stem and leaf plots going?
It's good, but I need to practice it.
Okay, let me just take a quick look and we'll see how we can get you to a got it level. Okay, I see you have your stem and all your numbers are correct on the stem and they're all correct on the leaf. You have a key, which is excellent. A lot of people forget the key. So I notice you don't have a title up here. If you could add a title next time. And also, in a stem and leaf, you're not actually required to have commas in there either.
Oh, okay.
I've got this. Actually, we all got this. We're moving on to something more challenging.
Tara, why do you use starting, getting there, got it to provide feedback to students?
Okay, well, as you saw from Ellen's reflection, it empowers students to take responsibility for their own learning. They have a clear path they know they need to go in for success, and they also have a process they know they need to follow to achieve that success.
Anthony, has doing this improved student disposition towards mathematics?
Actually, Linda, yes it has. By using pretests and data to group the students, it enables us to differentiate and give targeted feedback to enable each student to achieve growth, no matter which level they are entering at.
How does the strategy enhance your practices of differentiation?
Okay, by pre-testing each unit, we know exactly where the deficits in knowledge are in all of our students. We can then point students in the right direction to improve their understanding, and we can target teaching to suit specific needs of students. And we can also extend those that would normally sit there bored because they already knew those concepts. We have clear and precise data to track all students and ensure that they've achieved the desired standards, and then we can extend those who need it.
Is there any evidence of improvement in student learning outcomes?
Actually, yes, Linda, there has been a great influence. There's been a positive influence on the students' outcomes with upward movement from their pre-test to their post-test. This also is translating into their semester grades, which is great. However, this is not the only positive outcome. It's also increased student engagement. Students are staying on task for longer in class. Not only that, I've also noticed students are lining up to class really early and I cannot get them out at lunchtime. They just want to increase their understanding.
How would you utilise the starting, getting there, got it strategy in years 8 to 12?
Well, Linda, we've already actually implemented it for years 8 and 9 and we've had great success with completing that. We plan to roll it out in Year 11 and 12 in the coming year.
Can you tell us about how research informed the way you're giving feedback and exercising differentiation?
Anthony and I share an underpinning philosophy when teaching junior secondary. We want to maximise student engagement and maximise success. So to enable us to do that, we're continually looking for good research that will improve the effect size. Our model of feedback, where teachers and students work together to identify who's starting, getting there or got it, has several benefits. So it allows students to have a clear pathway to success. Students know exactly what they need to achieve and how they will achieve it. Feedback and data collection enables us to differentiate. For example, we can monitor and implement strategies to ensure our students are progressing from that surface to deep to transfer phases of their learning. This translates effectively into the getting there stage of student learning, where we implement strategies with high effect size, such as peer tutoring. So we also use schemas and scaffolding, which have proven to have a high effect size, such as the Venn diagram we use today, where students compare similarities and differences. The research says this has a whopping effect size of 1.32, so we use this. The use of feedback also demonstrates to students that we care about their mathematical growth. We have high expectations and we believe that they will achieve success and make that progress. So when we feedback together on the pre and post test data, we're always satisfied with the progress students have made. But of course, if there was a student who hadn't made progress, then we have that knowledge and we have the skills to further work with them to help them achieve success.
In this snapshot of practice, we saw a strategy for giving feedback. Starting, getting there, got it. We saw how it was utilised as a growth tool and how feedback given after formative assessment is improving student disposition towards mathematics and ultimately student learning outcomes. In education research, an effect size of 0.2 is relatively small and an effect size of 0.6 is large. The effect size for feedback is 0.7 and for deliberate practice, 0.79. So according to Almirotti, Fisher, Asoff, Hattie and Frey, both have the potential to considerably accelerate student achievement. Today, we witness teachers using deliberate instruction, which has an effect size of 0.6. Deliberate instruction is a great way to support students who are starting to get it, to transfer from surface to deep learning. These three questions can be used by individual teachers, professional learning teams or departments to guide a reflection on how teaching programs include activities that improve student disposition through feedback. Visit the STEM Hub for Schools and follow the link to the MInSTEM Ed Studio for further resources to help transform secondary mathematics.